So, we don't have to explain to you that it's disappointing that we're having to close down all of our house concerts because of the coronavirus, and we already had to cancel one, and then it became our turn to perform, and Viktors and I have been working on things for a whole year, and yeah, it's kind of disappointing, and it takes a lot of work to keep your pieces up and running, and so we just decided we just have to record them and put them out there, and that's going to be it. So this was going to be a completely a Grieg, Edvard Grieg concert, and I'll talk a little bit more about him, but I'm going to let Viktors tell you about what started this whole idea.
Well, I'm 71 years old, so back in the 50s, the 1950s, we lived in Michigan, Kalamazoo, Michigan. Well, we were relatively poor. We didn't have much stuff. We were immigrants. But we had a friend that lived in Chicago, and he worked at Admiral Electronics. And in one of our visits there, he gave us a 45 record player, a little thing where you'd stack up a bunch of 45s and play them. And we got two records. One of them had Take Me Out to the Ball Game on it. And I think on the other side was something on something like Oh Woman, Oh Woman. I don't even know what that was all about back then. But the second 45, I still have it right here. And it was by Liberace, of all people. And on one side is, it's called a Chopin Fantasia, where he has a whole bunch of Chopin pieces sort of melded together to get a feeling of Chopin. And on the other side is the Grieg Piano Concerto. And I heard this when I was a little kid. I played this over and over again until it's scratched to pieces, but I still have it. You can sort of still play it. Anyway, so I was very familiar with these pieces in my subconscious mind. I took piano lessons for, been seven-year-old till 8 years I took piano lessons from my uncle. And then when I stopped, I had never played any Chopin or Bach or anything yet. And in fact, I didn't like any of the stuff I was being taught to play. But my mom wanted me to get some technique at least, because she wished her parents had pushed her that far. And she regretted not doing it when she was a child. So she made me learn how to play scales and arpeggios and things. But after I quit taking lessons, I realized, gee, I could actually play something I wanted to play. And one of the pieces was a Chopin piece that was on this record. And then after that, I started working on the Grieg Piano Concerto, which is way, way too hard for me at the time. I mean, I was terrible at sight reading. And we had this old Adorf piano, which is same kind Sylvia had when she was a kid, interestingly.
We've never met anyone else that had that brand of piano, but we both had one.
It's an upright piano.
Different parts of the country.
Anyway, but the problem is you'd play a, you know, trying to play a concerto like this, you'd play a note on it and it would die out so fast that by the time you hit the next note, it just didn't make any sense. And you know, with sight reading being really bad on my capability list, I had to play extremely slowly, so it was really frustrating. And then on top of that, this piece had all these weird chords in it that sounded really dissonant, so when I'd play them, I wasn't sure if I was sight reading them wrong, or if I just was hearing it wrong, or playing it wrong, or what, you know. So I struggled through that for a while, and my uncle said, I can't play this piece, go play something else. So anyway, many years later now, I'm 71 years old. I've, in the last year or so, I've taken up learning the Grieg Piano Concerto family, and on a really nice piano now. And it's still not perfect, but I really like it. It's a nice piece. It's very, has a very familiar first movement that many of you might have heard, a very beautiful, gorgeous second movement, and a very exciting dance-like third movement. It's just a lot of fun. And unlike a lot of concertos, a concerto, by the way, is where you have a soloist playing sort of a show-off piece along with an orchestra. And so a piano concerto would be one where the pianist is a solo guy. But in this particular concerto, if you just play the piano part alone, it actually sounds like a nice piano piece. So you can just play it in a vacuum without an orchestra and still get by. Whereas many other concertos, you really need the orchestra to fill in the holes. So it also makes it sort of an attractive piece to learn.
So I played the orchestral part, which is a lot easier than the solo piano part.
I really thank her for doing it. She's my better half here in the piano world. See, did I have anything else to say about this? Maybe, but I can't think of what it is.
You can butt in while I'm talking.
Yeah.
Okay.
My biggest problem is actually nowadays is not the technique, but more memory. As I learn new parts of the thing, the things I learned before start sneaking back out. So it's like a
So because Viktors was working on this, it brought to mind a bunch of the lyric pieces that I had played by Grieg. I used to play at Rimsky-Korsakov Coffee House. I did that for over 20 years on Sunday nights. And I played a lot of the Grieg lyric pieces, which you may or may not have heard of. But this seemed to be an occasion to bring those back up with a new vision about them. And I decided not to skip any, to just start from the beginning and start learning them. And I learned 31 of them. There are 66. So I didn't play all of them for recordings, but I got all of them up to the point where I could play them for my piano groups in a reasonable fashion anyway. And I don't know, I may go back to them later and try to finish all of them, but not now. Anyway, I want to say a few words about Edvard Grieg. He was Norwegian. His years of life were 1843 to 1907, and he was recognized as a talent when he was a kid. He had, I think it was his mother's brother-in-law who was a violinist and said he has to go get trained. So he went to Germany and he was trained there. He doesn't have a terribly eventful life. There's not a lot of angst or, you know, terrible things that happen to him, which is great. You know, why would you wish that on anyone? But it doesn't make for a really exciting story. But I do want to say that he would fit in the category of what we would call a late romantic composer. And that word romantic does not mean falling in love. It means it was kind of an artistic movement that took over the 1800s in Europe, where people are, instead of going for form, and they're trying to let forth their emotions, a lot of emotive music and a lot of really grand music. And another theme in this romantic period was to go for kind of your national music, or try to get to the ethos of an ethnic people. That was another aspect of it. You know, think about the Grimm brothers, and they were out there collecting folk tales and that kind of thing. So they were a little earlier than Grieg, but it was still part of the same movement. And when he was in his late teens or early 20s, he became friends with a fellow, and I only know him because I read this in a book, Richard Nordraak, who was a Norwegian, and he suggested to Grieg that he should go for the national music of Norway. And this lit a fire under him, and I have a little quote that he wrote, and this is in a letter or something that he wrote to someone. Suddenly it was as though a veil was lifted from my eyes and I knew what I wanted to do. I think Nordraak showed me the way to my inner self. So from then on, he really went after Norwegian music, and he wove that through his writing in many different ways. In some cases, people had been out there collecting Norwegian tunes, folk tunes, and so there was this one book out there, and he used that quite a bit. But he also did some collecting on his own, and he also just used kind of Norwegian-like like modes and folk dances and things like that in a lot of his writing. And he also he wrote a lot of songs. His wife was a fine soloist, a soprano, and he wrote with her voice in mind. He wrote over 150 songs, and one of the books I've read suggested that his songs were the best of his writing, but they were all in Norwegian. So they're not real well known to, I would say, the larger public, but I have a CD of them. I've listened to it over and over, and they're just beautiful. But anyway, to go back to this Norwegian theme in his writing, he also was inspired by, well, poets for writing the songs, but also just folk tales, mythologies, and so in his pieces, there are a lot of names of pieces like elves and trolls and dwarfs and things like that that go back to some of the mythology. So the concerto is one of his bigger pieces. He wrote it when he was 25, and he had an inspiration. He wrote it. It kind of brought him to fame. But he really didn't write a whole lot of big pieces, and he considered that a curse, and because he liked the miniature. But I don't consider that a curse. He even wrote he thought his music wasn't going to last. They were written for now. Here it is, you know, over 100 years later, and they're just still going strong, and they're still to be discovered in some ways. He said, this is one of his quotes to a friend when he was talking about wanting to write bigger stuff, and he says, I regret to say that I recently turned once again to the lyric. Can you not rid me of this disease? The things I want to compose do not get composed. The things I do not want to get composed. And in other words, he kept writing little miniatures, which are just little worlds in themselves. I love those pieces. They're so complete, they're so artistic, and the more I worked on his pieces, the more I grew to appreciate him as a composer. It's very well thought out. It's not overly emotional, and yet the emotion is all there. And so I would have, if we were doing this live, I would have talked about various pieces before I played them, but I'm not going to do that. They'll just stand for their own. I just want to say that they're just lovely. And they are written more for house music. They're not huge concert pieces for the most part. But they are little masterpieces, and so I hope you appreciate what we play for you.
Oh, and I have one other thing to say about the concerto. Apparently, when Grieg met Franz Liszt, the famous pianist, for the first time, Franz Liszt had not seen the concerto before. He sight read it, first time, perfectly faster than it was supposed to be played, according to the stories I read, although there's some speculation that he might have gotten an early copy somewhere along the way to look at it, but still pretty amazing. Anyway, sorry about the coronavirus here. We're gonna probably just have to do video recorded house concerts, virtual house concerts for a while until the pandemic subsides. Please stay safe in the meantime. And I hope you enjoy these recordings. Thanks.
And you know it's a lot more fun to play live, but hope you enjoy them.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.